Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and it's, as always, it's a pleasure to speak in the House on behalf of my constituents. We're here today to discuss Bill C-24 because of the government's failure to manage the House of Commons effectively. We are seeing that this government has created a crisis through their mismanagement. Once again, we're up against a hard deadline with benefits expiring for Canadians, and this government not managing the House calendar, not managing their legislation so that we can consider this fully. We're now, this bill before us today expands the spending of the government by $12 billion, $12.1 billion. And because of how this is going to go, we'll debate it for about 6 hours. So about $2 billion an hour, Mr. Speaker, in terms of what we're going to be able to discuss and review here. And as has been said, this does fix a problem that is a result of the government's first attempt to provide benefits to Canadians, Bill C-2, which was rushed at that time through the House to once again meet a deadline that the government knew about but failed to plan for, failed to present legislation in a timely fashion to the House. That time it was because they had prorogued the House, the Prime Minister had prorogued the House, shut everything down, eliminated all the legislation that was on the order paper because of the We Charity scandal. Things were getting a little too hot on that at the time, and it was time to shut down the investigations into the Prime Minister and his involvement in the We Charity scandal. So they prorogued Parliament, which created this rush to get legislation before an October deadline when the CERB would end. So it was rushed through, and they didn't realize that they had provided in that legislation a $1,000 bonus to people who had gone on leisure vacations outside of the country. They could apply and get $1,000 so that they could sit at home during their 14-day quarantine after international travel. The government, because it was passed, as has been said here, we needed to get the benefits to Canadians whose CERB was expiring, but they didn't have committee studies, we didn't have a debate in the House because of the government's mismanagement of this file. They saw a deadline, they didn't care, they rushed, they made mistakes. And I think that is indicative of this government's approach. And we're seeing it again today, not only in this debate, but another important debate, I would argue one of the most important debates that this House will face in this Parliament, is being cut short on Bill C-7 and the Senate amendments because of this government's failure to plan, to provide legislation, to provide opportunities for parliamentarians to intervene on behalf of their constituents. So we have a situation later this day where debate will be shut off on Bill C-7, and the Senate amendments, which call for the expansion of medical aid in dying to include people who have only mental illness or disabilities, disabling conditions, will now have access to medical aid in dying, something that has not been studied by this Parliament, something that has not been studied in the committee. But because of this government's mismanagement, their failure to respond in a timely fashion to court decisions and legislative deadlines, we now have a situation where yet another bill, in addition to this one, is jammed up against a deadline where they're forcing parliamentarians to address complex issues, and in this case, life and death issues, with almost no time in this House because of their failure and mismanagement. And people in my riding are very concerned about that. They're concerned about this government's inability to manage this House, to manage debate, to manage legislation in a way that addresses their concerns. I've had people write to me, they've showed me the one organization I want to highlight from my riding. The Chilliwack Society for Community Living has signed an important letter from the Vulnerable Persons Standard, which calls on members of Parliament to do better. And they say that Bill C-7 sets apart people with disabilities and disabling conditions as the only Canadians to be offered assistance in dying when they're not actually nearing death. It's dangerous, it's discriminatory, And they're hearing MPs and senators say that lives just like theirs, featuring just disabilities just like theirs, are not livable. It's harmful, hurtful, and stigmatizing. They say, take your time, start over, and get this right. As you do so, be careful to heed the advice of the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Listen closely to the most directly affected. Their antenna is highly attuned to ableism. When they see it, you should pause and reflect before proceeding. Bill C-7 is not the answer. This is another example, as is C-24, of a government failing to take the time to allow Parliament to deliberate to get something right. If we'd had the time to deliberate on Bill C-2, if the government hadn't shut down Parliament and rushed that up against the CERB deadline, I'm sure that someone along the way in the debate, in the committees, with the witnesses, would have identified this failure to protect, to focus the benefits where they were meant to be focused, for people who had to take sick leave because of COVID-19, not people who needed to take a vacation because of COVID-19. That would have been identified had we had proper debate. And it's here again today, 6 hours of debate. It has to be rushed. We're accused after 2 hours of being obstructionist and failing to do our jobs on behalf of Canadians. Only a Liberal government would think that the solution to problems that they created by rushing a bill through Parliament previously could be solved by rushing another bill through Parliament again. And that is the failure of this government. So what are we doing here? We're, again, I mentioned $12.1 billion to expand benefits, to extend benefits to Canadians, which we've supported all along, is the benefits going to Canadians who, through no fault of their own, have found their workplaces closed, have found their opportunities eliminated, have been forced into restrictive lockdowns. And when governments force you out of your job and make the conditions so that you can't go to work, they have an obligation to provide you with an alternate income. But, Mr. Speaker, this can't go on forever. We are here again, and we're extending it, Conservative support, extending the benefits to the people who need it. But what we also need now is a plan to get past this, a plan to address the lockdowns, a plan to show Canadians that there's hope for the future. And that's why we've been calling on the Prime Minister to present that plan to Canadians. And we've introduced a petition. The member for Calgary Nose Hill has called on the Prime Minister to use the tools that we have gathered in the last year to help us get past this. We are calling on the Prime Minister to immediately present a clear plan to get Canadians safely out of lockdown, and that this plan include data-driven goals, a plan of action, and a timeline to achieve those goals, and ensure that the plan is articulated to Canadians so that they can have hope about when life and business will return to normal. We know that there have been problems with the vaccine rollout, with vaccine procurement. We know that there's been issues with conflicting advice given to Canadians during this pandemic. We're a year into it today, and we've commemorated the lives that have been lost, but we also need to think about the lives that are being severely and permanently impacted right now. People that are experiencing extreme mental health concerns, people that are not getting the health screening that they need for cancer and heart disease, people that are unable to join with others to worship freely as is protected by the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. We need a plan forward so that we are not only coming again and again up against deadlines, as this government has, to extend these benefits time and time again. We'll be there when Canadians need us, but we also need to start talking about the plan and the way forward to ensure that these are not just simply permanent benefits, that the next benefit is to help our economy grow, help people get past these restrictions safely while listening to public health advice, but we need a plan. And we haven't received it from this government. All we've seen from this government is incompetence, mismanagement of this House, and mistakes being made time and time again. Mr. Speaker, we need to do better.
Questions and comments. We'll first go to the Honourable Parliamentary Secretary to the Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And the member is absolutely wrong. You know, at the end of the day, the Conservatives have been playing a very destructive force and role inside the House of Commons in recent weeks and months. Let there be no doubt about that. In fact, Madam Speaker, or Mr. Speaker, we've even had some opposition parties recently comment in terms of the role that the Conservative Party has been playing. The only reason why we now see in the last 24 hours is because they have been shamed into doing some of the things that they're currently doing. The member complains about C-24. There's a number of pieces of legislation in which the Conservative Party has deliberately attempted to try to delay and ultimately see bills not passed. C-7 is a good example. We attempted to extend the hours, Mr. Speaker. When the member says, well, what about due diligence? There's plenty of opportunities to provide that due diligence. Will the member take responsibility for the irresponsible behavior of the official opposition and recognize that it is, in fact, time that we start working together once again?
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Parliamentary Secretary to the Government House Leader thinks that it's offensive when anyone other than him is speaking in this House of Commons. When anyone other than him is speaking, they're filibustering. When anyone other than him is speaking, it's obstructionist. He was calling us obstructionist on Bill C-24 2 hours after the bill had been read in the House for the first time. The second reading debate had barely started, and this member was already accusing opposition members of obstruction. It is this government's incompetence, it is his House Leader's incompetence that has caused any log jams. They failed to introduce bills in a logical order. They failed to call them in a timely fashion. He's the one who should be apologizing and maybe let someone else speak every once in a while without calling it a filibuster.
Questions and comments. The Honourable Member for Timmins, James Bay.
Thank you. I listened with great interest, my honourable colleague. I want to not challenge him, but I think maybe correct the record for people listening. It's not just that the government is pushing through Bill C-7. What they've allowed to happen here is the unelected, unaccountable Senate have rewritten the law of Canada so people with depression will be able to ask to die in 2 years. And this Liberal government is supporting that. This is ignoring what Parliament stands for. Parliament does the hard work. Parliament would go out. Any member of Parliament who went back to their constituents and says, instead of having suicide prevention or mental health programs, I'd like to make it easier for people with mental illness to die, there would be an outcry, there would be headlines, there would be debate. That would be democratic. It's the fact that this Liberal government is using the unelected and unaccountable Senate to fundamentally change a basic principle of the right to life in this country that I find is appalling. And the fact that they want to rush it through the House because they say that we've obstructed, they are obstructing the democratic rights of this House.
The Honourable Member for Chilliwack-Hope.
Well, I thank the member for that question. I'd say they are doing more than just obstructing. This is perhaps the most serious matter that we will ever consider. It certainly is the most serious matter that we will consider in my 10 years, almost 10 years as an elected official. To have a government and unelected senators, I agree with that member, say to people in our lives, many of whom we have struggled to keep them alive, to keep them from making the wrong choice of taking their own life, to say, if you want to take your own life, now there's a system in place for it. Instead of standing up and increasing supports for people with mental health, instead of increasing supports for people with disabilities and different abilities, they're saying, I know you're not at the end of your life, there's no prospect of you dying, but now there is, because the unelected Senate has taken away the protections for people who have mental illness in this country, and for the government to rush that through and to accept those terrible amendments is an affront to this democratically elected place, and they truly should be ashamed of themselves. And for what this will do, we're going to have a time, Mr. Speaker, where future parliamentarians stand up and apologize for what is about to happen later today, where we vote in favor, we won't be, but when this government votes to make it easy for mentally ill and disabled people to take their own lives, it is a tragedy, Mr. Speaker.